everybody. Welcome back to the Film Buds podcast. This is episode number 271, and my name is Henry.
I'm Elle.
This week, we have something special. We have, I guess, what could be called our first tribute episode. We've done actor and director-specific episodes, but I guess not really a tribute, as this one is going to be, which is a Robin Williams tribute, because is it his birthday?
His birthday passed July 24th. First, and his death anniversary is August 11th.
So yesterday. Yeah. So yeah, we're going to be just talking a little bit about him at first, you know, like, you know, who he was, what he was famous for, and then we're going to be doing three of his movies. We're going to be starting with Aladdin, the original Disney animated film, and then Mrs. Doubtfire, you know, which is, you know, one of his most well-known, and then one that is slightly lesser known, I think, at least I didn't know about it until recently, Bicentennial Man from 1999. So, you know, three kind of fairly different ones, and, you know, hopefully it'll be a good time, a nice talk. We haven't really talked about Robin Williams much at all on the show before, so long time coming. Well, how are you?
Doing all right. Pretty tired. What about you?
Yeah, same here. Been working this weekend and doing all right, hanging in there.
But hey, you got off early. Yeah. Tonight,
mm-hmm. So. That was nice. But other than that, same old, I guess. A couple of quick things. So, first of all, we have had a pretty big recent spike in listenership. Even just over the last week, we've had our podcast data, you know, stat site said, we've had a 746% increase and listenership.
So yeah, that's pretty crazy.
Pretty crazy. So thank you to all those people, you know, if you subscribed or if you just, you know, checked in and out, you know, whichever one, thank you for listening, and we'll hope you'll stick around, subscribe and rate and follow us on social media and on Letterboxd. So thank you very much to all those people. We, you know, really appreciate it.
Thank you. And you know what? The best is yet to come for the Film Buds.
Hey, I think so too. It's been 7 years, you know, so it's about time. So, and then another thing, if you aren't already aware, so we have about 20 bonus shows up on Bandcamp, which is thefilmbuds.bandcamp.com, on different actors, directors, franchises, and I've been doing some solo ones that I've been putting up there, and then Elle also has some ideas for TV shows that she's going to be doing.
Oh, yeah. Big Little Lies, Summer I Turned Pretty, and Just Like They It. Sorry, I just love mispronouncing things. It's fun. I'll be doing And Just Like That season 1 and 2 when it comes to rap. So keep an eye out on that.
So yeah, all those you can get for just a $1 minimum donation. You can always donate more, and it all just goes to help support the show, and it's just extra content that helps, you know, fill in the gaps of stuff that maybe we didn't do on the show years ago or right now that we've missed. So check that out as well if you haven't already, and thank you to the people who have gotten them. Anything else? We have a lot to talk about here.
I don't think so. I'm just kind of experiencing a little burnout.
Yeah.
When it comes to, if you guys don't already know, I own Elle DeWeese Photography. You can check that out on Instagram, and then my website link is in my Instagram bio. But you get a lot of weird people reaching out to you. I mean, okay, just debated with Henry on whether or not I want to talk about this weird inquiry. But I posted on Facebook wanting to do some spooky solo and couple sessions for Halloween, because I love all things spooky, and I think that would be really cool. This guy contacted me, and he wasn't really understanding like what I was saying. Like, I feel like I was explaining the process of booking pretty thoroughly and like 3 times, and he still wasn't getting it. And he also wants to wear like a tight leather jumpsuit, as he said. I'm just a little uncomfortable because it's just gonna be him. I don't know. I just get a very weird vibe. I'm always down to do, you know, spooky, weird shoots, but I don't know. Usually if I get a weird vibe from someone, I do not book.
People, you know?
Well, people in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Yeah. Well, best of luck with that.
Thanks. But maybe I can share some weird client stories on here.
Sure.
Hopefully they won't listen to it.
Yeah.
Anyway.
All right. Well, should we jump in?
I guess so. I guess that's our only option here.
Either that or just, you know, call it quits. Just end of the show now.
Yeah.
All right. Well, now, do you want to start off? Because, I mean, you have some stuff prepared here. Do you want to just talk about Robin Williams as a whole first, or do this first and then talk about him?
I guess let's talk about him first and just, I mean, I don't know who on the planet Earth doesn't know about Robin Williams. But I would like these tribute episodes to, you know, have like a little bio of them and then, you know, us review movies of theirs. So I guess I will start. So if you didn't already know, Robin Williams was an American actor and comedian known for his unique stand-up routines and his wide range of film performances. The man can do it all. Mm. He can do, you know, voice work for Aladdin. He can do comedies like Mrs. Doubtfire. And then he can do weird drama robot love stories like Bicentennial Man. He was born July 21st, 1951. He unfortunately died August 11th, 2014. So he's been gone for 9 years now, which is shocking. He would have been 72 this year. He's won many Grammy Awards and Emmy Awards, along with an Academy Award for his performance in Good Will Hunting. He's best known for his roles in Mrs. Doubtfire, Good Will Hunting, Dead Poets Society, Aladdin, Good Morning Vietnam, Hook, and Jumanji. And of course, his role in the museum movie.
Night at the Museum.
Yes, Teddy Roosevelt. So, yeah, today we'll be discussing Aladdin. As you said, maybe we'll cut that. So, honorable mentions that almost made the cut for this episode. Dead Poets Society, Good Will Hunting, and The Birdcage. If you guys haven't checked out The Birdcage, please go do so.
It's a classic.
It's a classic. It's funny. You know, even is a hit with older parents.
Yeah.
They find it funny.
Also, Insomnia is another good one. Christopher Nolan movie. That's a solid one.
But yeah, I guess we'll jump. I guess we'll jump right into it.
Yeah. Well, so now Robin Williams, I grew up with some of his movies. I think Jumanji was the one that stands out. That one kind of scared me as a kid, but I still, you know, that one is still one I really like, and it's kind of hard to dislike him. I doubt there's many people who watch his movies and dislike him. So, he has one of those personalities and one of those faces. But so I've always been a big fan of his. You know, there's still some gaps in his filmography that I haven't seen, but whenever he's on screen, it's always enjoyable, whether it's a drama or a horror movie or anything like that. So it is very sad that he, you know, left us much too soon, but he did leave quite a career behind him and a legacy behind him.
He's a legend.
So yeah, I'm glad we are finally getting around to talking about him on the show.
Now, I do have a confession.
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen Jumanji.
Whoa.
And I know that's a classic, and I know I might get hate.
Listeners just turned off there.
Yeah, I know. But I think one of my favorite films of his is Dead Poets Society. I don't know why my junior year English teacher in high school decided to show us Dead Poets Society, because it's fucking depressing.
Mm.
Literally unalived himself, but besides the point, that movie was one of the many reasons I decided to go into education. Am I a teacher now? No.
Maybe later.
But that movie really touched me, and it made me want to go into education.
Yeah. Well, there you go.
So thank you, Robin Williams.
Yeah, Insomnia, like I said, is another kind of underrated dramatic role. The Christopher Nolan film, One Hour Photo, is one where he plays it's a very creepy movie. So he definitely has versatility. Oh, shit,
I've been wanting to see that.
Yeah.
Doesn't he, like, work at the JCPenney?
It's like the photo play setup. Yeah, like a retail store.
But it seems
store.
Like a JCPenney.
Something like that.
Oh, my God, yes. Yeah. I want to see that so bad.
Yeah, so that's a good one. So he definitely has some pretty underrated roles, in my opinion. But, yeah, well, do you want to talk about Aladdin?
Sure. Let's
get on the magic carpet.
Let's get on the magic carpet and
fly away.
Go to the Middle East, man.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
All right. Well, we do have a clip, as always. So take a listen.
Take a listen.
Okay, go. Try this. Your taste buds will dance and sing. Hey, get your paws off. Why, you... Get away from here, you cursed, filthy ape! Nice going, Abu. Breakfast is served. Pretty lady, buy a pot. No finer pot in brass or silver.
Sugar dates and figs, sugar dates and pistachios.
Would the lady like a necklace? A pretty necklace for a pretty lady.
Fresh fish! We catch him, you buy him!
No, I don't think so. Oh, excuse me. I'm really very sorry.
Okay, so first one is Aladdin. Came out in 1992. Who knew there were movies made before I was born?
And I surely before didn't. I was born.
Yeah, I didn't think that was a thing, but I guess it was. So
wait, there's movies before?
All of these are. Or I guess Bicentennial Man was 99. Anyways.
I'm kidding. Okay, go ahead.
Directed by Ron Clements and John Musker, and stars Robin Williams, Scott Weinger, Linda Larkin, Jonathan Freeman, Frank Welker, Gilbert Gottfried. No one else that stands out, I think.
Well, fun fact, scroll down. Scott Weiner played Steve in Full House.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Hmm. So, fun fact there.
Interesting.
And wait. No, okay. No, that was Matthew Broderick. I was going to say he also played in the line. It was Matthew Broderick. Hmm. Anyway.
And the synopsis is a kind-hearted street urchin and a power-hungry grand vizier vie for a magic lamp that has the power to make their deepest wishes come true. So this one, was, I guess, in the early 90s, so kind of that Disney animation prime spot for animation, you know, the 90s animation. So definitely is one that has, you know, pretty big reputation, beloved by many. And, of course, they did remake it recently, which we did review on the show way back when. So this one I saw sometime when I was a kid, but it was not one that really stuck with me all that much, or was just one I didn't watch that often. I am a big fan of Disney animation, and that, again, that 90s time was pretty awesome, pretty classic and iconic. I think rewatching it, this may be a hot take.
Okay.
I don't love the movie.
You don't love the movie?
No, I think Robin Williams is fantastic in the role. I think whenever he's on screen, or whenever, you know, the genie is on screen, it's funny, it's charming. But I find leading up to him getting in the movie, I find it to kind of drag and be slow. I find typically when he's not on screen, I'm kind of bored. So,
I mean, that's fair because, I mean, he's Robin Williams.
Yeah, but I mean, I just find that the overall story, like, I think in the remake, it is a little bit more flashy and accessible, which, you know, I like that movie to a certain extent, but this one I find kind of is a little too slow for me.
But see, I don't mind that because, of course, it's going to be slow before the genie arrives. And then,
I think even afterwards. And so I find the overall plot to kind of be boring. That's the biggest issue I have, is typically when it's not Robin Williams doing, like, you know, dance and song numbers and stuff, I'm not really that invested. And in comparison to other Disney animation movies at the time, I think this is much lower on the list. So I still find it looks amazing. The songs are great.
I mean, that is fair because Aladdin isn't my favorite Disney movie. So I can see where you're coming from. I just don't agree with it being slow. But I mean, if I had to pick my favorite Disney movie, I would say Beauty and the Beast because, I mean, I'm just thinking about what you're saying. It's not slow. So yeah. I guess I kind of get your point.
Mm. Yeah. So, I mean, a little bit. With movies like that, I don't really typically don't have that issue. So that's why whatever reason, this one hits me in that way. And so I still like the movie to a certain extent. I just am not in love with it as much as some people are. Maybe it hasn't aged well. I don't know.
There is that warning now.
Yeah.
Before you watch it.
But, you know, visually still awesome. Good performances. Robin Williams is, you know, iconic in it. Definitely made a stamp. It's just that I think going back and watching it now, I'm not a huge fan. I'm not through the roof. Hate to say it. Sorry.
That's fair.
But what about you?
Well, rewatching it as an adult, I actually enjoyed it more, and just solely because of Robin Williams. Hmm. I don't mind the slowness, but I enjoyed rewatching it. I don't really have any critiques. Is the animation great? No, but it was like in 19.
I'd say it is. I think it still looks pretty good.
I mean, it has its moments. It's not like now. That's what I'm
kind yeah.
of. Yeah. I just really liked Robin Williams as the and that's why I wanted to include this one.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so visually, I mean, you know, I think honestly some of these movies look better than a lot of ones that come out now. I think it has kind of a more timeless feel to it. And, you know, whereas movies now are some of the animation is a little bit more, you know, it looks much more digital and a little too smooth sometimes, whereas this one I feel like has kind of a nice aged look to it. So I still think it looks pretty awesome. But yeah, you know, I wish one, you know, maybe going back and rewatching it some other time, maybe I'll think of it differently, but it was not winning me over when I was watching it. Well, anything else big about this one?
Not really. I just feel like I don't have a lot to say about Disney.
Why?
because it's, I don't know, because I feel like the voice work always hits. The songs always hit. Like, all of them are great for the most part. I feel like I can't really critique, like, a classic story.
That's fair.
It's classic. It's like critiquing the story of, like, Pinocchio and Cinderella. It's like, okay. Like, you can't really critique a I don't know. If we ever do, like, any, like, old Disney movies, I feel like I'm not gonna have much to say. If we do like that new Pixar movie Elemental, I feel like I will have a lot to say, if that makes any sense.
That's fair,
because I feel like I've just rewatched Aladdin over and over and over as a kid. So I just don't
Interesting,
same as like Beauty and the Beast and Cinderella and the Lion King.
All right, well, out of five then. I'll go 3.5.
I rate it 5 stars.
Whoa. Yeah, well, it's 3.5 for me. Be curious. You know, let us know what you think when we post the episode out. What y'all think, or on Letterboxd. You can comment on our, you know, reviews and stuff. So make sure to do that.
Yeah.
Well, all right. Well, should we move on? Oh, what's up?
Letterboxd review.
Oh, right. Right.
So Letterboxd review time. If you see our lineup for the month and you have a very good review that on Letterboxd that you want us to read, please either email us a screenshot, tweet us, or DM us on Instagram at the Film Buds Podcast. So maybe your review can be featured.
Yeah.
Lindsay rated it 4.5 stars. She said, Jasmine kissed that bitch Jafar to give Aladdin a few seconds of free time to steal the lamp back, and he wasted those seconds staring at them in disgust. Didn't get the lamp, which means she had to kiss Jafar's ugly ass for no reason. I can't believe she ever forgave Aladdin for that, because I haven't.
Whoa.
That's a good point.
So this one comes from Olivia, 4.5 and a heart. And she says, Jafar turning into a snake is the single scariest moment in all of cinematic history.
That is true. That animation was a little scary. Used to scare me as a kid. So, and you can read that one.
So 5 stars. No, you can read that one.
Featuring Dante from the DMC series. They rated it 5 stars. They say, fuck this shit, bro. I miss Robin Williams.
Yeah.
I feel that.
But all right, well, let's move on to second film, which is Mrs. Doubtfire from 1993.
Oh, how exciting.
And we do have a clip as well. So take a listen.
Daniel, hi.
Could you make me a woman?
Honey, I'm so happy.
Oh, come on. I knew you'd understand. Is this gonna hurt?
Don't whine, just relax.
Are you sure?
Just remember, pain is beauty. Okay, here we go. Take a deep breath. Instant eye lift.
Wow. And you'll never see the strings that'll be under the wig.
The man has 5 o'clock shadow at 8:30 a.m. and you're worried about strings?
All right, we'll start with makeup.
I'm not gonna wax.
Don't worry, we'll just lightly spackle.
Feel like Gloria Swanson.
You look like her mother.
I'm ready for my close-up, Mr. DeMille.
Okay, everyone. Let's pray.
All right, so as I said, Mrs. Doubtfire came out in 1993, directed by Chris Columbus, who also did Bicentennial Man, and it stars Robin Williams, Sally Field, Pierce Brosnan, Harvey Fierstein, Polly Holiday, Matthew Lawrence, that's about it. And the synopsis is, after a bitter divorce, an actor disguises himself as a female housekeeper to spend time with his children held in custody by his former wife. So this one definitely is, I think, one of the, considered to be one of the favorites of Robin Williams. I know it is in my family, and it's, I think it's, it is probably my favorite of his performances. And yeah, well, do you want to kick it off or?
Sure, I will kick it off this time. I know I had to watch this movie at some point when I was little, but I didn't remember a thing about it. So it was like watching it for the first time. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed it. I laughed. His impressions at the beginning were amazing with the smoking bird.
Yeah.
Amazing. I mean, I find it kind of sad, though, that this man had to dress up as like a 70-year-old woman to be able to be with his kids. Mm. That is pretty damn sad, in my opinion.
Yeah.
But once you get over the sadness, it's so ridiculous, it's funny. I mean, just that scene of that woman from the court, like, walking in to check his house out. And he was dressed up as Mrs. Doubtfire. Amazing.
Yeah.
I think this movie really shows off Robin Williams' voice talent. But the thing is, though, I can't believe they fell for that shit as long as they did.
Hmm. That's fair.
I feel like if you came to me, like, dressed up as, like, an older woman... But it's just amazing that they didn't, he looks like himself, like same, like facial features, just a wig, basically.
Yeah.
So it's just pretty funny, pretty funny.
Yeah.
Let's see. I don't really have any complaints for this movie. I just really enjoyed watching it because it was like my first time watching it.
Hmm.
Again, like, I know I watched it some point in my childhood, but I just don't remember. So yeah, I'm definitely gonna rewatch it when I need a good laugh. But I've been saying around the house, oh dear.
Yeah,
but it's just a fucking classic.
Yeah, so I saw this movie growing up and saw it a few times over the years. It had been a while since I had seen it up until just recently, and yeah, it's still pretty awesome. Robin, it is, my favorite of his performances, I would say, at least so far. So Chris Columbus, who also did Bicentennial Man, he also directed Home Alone and the first two.
Yeah, you can really tell that it was directed by the guy from Home Alone because the setting, the lighting, just the style of the movie, really.
Yeah, and he also directed the first two Harry Potter films as well.
Oh, really?
I didn't know that. So, definitely has some pretty iconic films, including this one, under his belt. And, it's well-directed, it's well-written, it's consistently very funny. A lot of that comes from performance. Robin Williams is... Because, you could read a lot of those lines, and a lot of them might not even be that funny on the page, but how he delivers them is, incredibly funny.
Right, throughout. Even like, oh dear.
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
So, yeah, I mean, that stuff, like, it's almost how, like, yeah, it, so that stuff works. And I think that's why it's aged very well, is it's most of it comes from performance and direction. I think with this movie, And I mean, and with Bicentennial Man, but really with most of his performances, you know, obviously, you know, he did take his own life and he's, you know, struggled with depression for most of his life, which is not something that most people knew about until afterwards. You know, I certainly didn't. But I think, you know, watching this movie and watching his performances, you can definitely sense a sadness in him, which I, in some ways for a performance makes it more interesting because there's like a mystery there. There's another dimension. But at the same time, knowing how his life ended, that makes it all the more sad of how he was in his real life. But performance wise, that works. But you can always kind of sense that. At least I've always felt that. But he is, you know, so funny, but also very dramatic in the movie. Just the weird little predicaments that he gets himself into trying to hide who he really is, or, you know,
like the restaurant scene.
Yeah, like the restaurant scene, or the one you were mentioning where he was having to change back and forth. All that stuff is hilarious and, you know, just classic. And, but, you know, also a lot of good heart in the movie, you know, good performances across the board, very heartwarming and, you know, charming, feel good, maybe a little long, but other than that,
I don't think it was a little long. Eh. I think it was pretty perfect. Yeah. And it was wrapped up pretty good.
Yeah, it's fair enough. It takes place in San Francisco. My brother may have popped in there. Actually, I guess he probably wasn't. No, he was born. Yeah. But wasn't in San Francisco at the time, I hope. But
hey, John.
Yeah. So yeah, very good movie. It's one that never really gets old. Seen a few times. I'm sure I feel like anybody who watches it would at least enjoy it to a certain degree. It's a easy to love movie, you know. So
but question. Do you think if it was released now, it would be as accepted?
I mean, I think that there are some lines in there that are a little dated, certain jokes and stuff. And so I think that, again, time and place, you know, it's not too bad. Maybe it would have a slightly different reception. I don't know. But I think 90s was, you know, pretty good decade for movies. And so I'm glad this came out when it did, you know.
Anyway, do you have anything else to add?
I don't think so. It's just, if you haven't seen it, check it out.
Please dress up as Mrs. Doubtfire for Halloween.
Well, I'll see if I can trick you one day. I'll just come over. I'll be our housekeeper. You know, say, ooh.
You should definitely dress up as Mrs. Doubtfire for Halloween.
I'll let you know if she falls for it.
Yeah, okay. I know no one here, so I wouldn't. I wouldn't fall for it. Thank you.
Fair enough. Anyways, star ratings? I gave 4.5. Probably could easily be a 5, but 4.5 this time.
Yeah, I gave it a 4.5 too.
All right.
So Letterboxd reviews. All right. This is a long one. We're only going to do 2. Comes from
Mikkel Stongren.
Or is it Michael? Okay. Mikkel.
That's how I think.
He rated it 4.5 stars. He said, having been a child of divorce myself, there were more than a few things that hit close to home when I saw this the first time around. Now, after watching it again roughly 2 decades later, I still love it as much as I did back then. The story is heartfelt and genuine, even if it can be argued that it isn't very believable in some regards. What truly matters here, though, is all the fun, laughter, and immense warmth it emits. Naturally, with greatest credit to the late Robin Williams, who really knew how to kick life into these type of high concept comedies. If you want realism, go watch a documentary. If you want to be entertained for once, as compared to all the dull and soulless family flicks being produced these days, see Mrs. Doubtfire, for it might make your day just a little bit brighter. Rest in peace, Robin. You may have left the physical world, but spiritually, you will always hover over the countless performances in which you shined and will continue to for as long as there are video players, computers, and admirers passing on your captured gifts to future generations. Thank you for all the laughs. Thank you for enhancing my childhood and helping me through a traumatic chapter of it. Thank you for showing us all the magic, whether through humor, human kindness, or a wholehearted voice or screen performance is a very real and achievable thing.
Well said.
That made me tear up. Mikkel.
I'm getting misty.
That actually made me tear up. Because that's why I wanted to have this episode.
Yeah, I agree. Well said, Mikkel. You gotta give her a moment, people.
No, it just kind of hit me. Okay. Kayla rated it 3 stars. She said, imagine falling for this shit.
That's fair. That's on them, really. So, all right, well, let's move on to Bicentennial Man, the last film we will be discussing.
All right, let's become robots.
Yeah, which is came out in 1999. And we do have a clip as well. Take a listen.
I've actually gotten to a point where I can pretty much exactly replicate the external physical appearance of a human being.
Remarkable. Thank you. Amazing. Unfortunately, nobody seems terribly interested in funding my research, but...
I am. I will fund your research.
Yeah? That'd be cool.
All right, so, as I said, Bicentennial Man came out in 1999, directed by Christopher Columbus as well, along with Robin Williams, has Sam Neill, Imbeth, Davidetz, Oliver Platt, Wendy Crewson, Hailee Eisenberg, John Michael Higgins, Bradley Whitford, Brett Wagner. That's about it, I think. And the synopsis is an android endeavors to become human as he gradually acquires emotions. So this was one that, as I said, I had heard of, I think, but didn't watch until you suggested it. So it was a first time watch for me, little old me. Do you want to start or shall I?
You can start this time.
Okay. So, you know, this movie, you know, follows a fairly familiar formula, as I'd say most Christopher Columbus movies do. Not that that's really a bad thing, but, you know, it's this fish out of water story, you know, where, you know, the robot's trying to learn human ways. And there's all, of course, there's the conflict there, people not wanting him there, him trying to learn how to behave in certain, you know, has all the normal stuff. So it's not like it's really breaking some crazy new ground there. But, you know, having Robin Williams be the titular Bicentennial Man, you know, his performance is very good when he is the robot, as well as when he becomes human, spoiler. But so he's, you know, it's yet another, I don't think there's a bad Robin Williams performance, but he is very good in this once again. And Sam Neill is always a great addition to a movie. He's always very good. And he's, you know, very good as the father. Overall, you know, I find the movie to sometimes kind of drag a little bit. I think the first half is a little bit more interesting than the second, where he's, you know, getting there. It is really the fish out of water part of the movie. And, you know, the second half where he's becoming more and more human, it's still interesting and entertaining, but I find it to be a little bit slower and not as entertaining as the first half. You know, good score, looks good. You know, Christopher Columbus has a very, that childlike kind of heartwarming atmosphere to his movies, which I really appreciate, which is why, you know, those first two Harry Potter movies are so, I feel like they really stand out amongst the rest of them. But yeah, you know, overall, I liked it well enough. Not really one that I'm going to really feel the need to revisit all that frequently, but still a good time. How about you?
Well, this is another movie that I watched when I was a kid, and I don't remember anything of it. I remember parts. I just remembered that Robin Williams was a robot. But I watched it tonight. And so it's very fresh. I really liked it. I thought it was a sweet story. You know, it had, like what you were saying, kind of a child-like feel to it. I have to disagree with your hot take of it being slow. I felt like it wasn't slow or fast. It was just right.
Just in the middle.
And I really enjoyed watching it. It was weird that he was gone. Like, he was supposedly gone for 10 years and then it turned into 20. So I didn't really understand that. But Robin Williams is phenomenal in this movie. Even, like, when when Andrew turned into Robin Williams' character, turned into like quote unquote human, like had the like flesh to start out with, he like moved like a robot. Did you notice that? He moved like a robot, which was really cool. So he like, you know, kept that, and then experiencing emotions for the first time, you know, I mean, every step along the way, Robin Williams was phenomenal.
Yeah.
However, what broke my heart, though, at the end is him aging.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, oh, shit. Like, we're never going to see that.
Yeah.
And that's really a shame. And I hate that not a lot of people knew Robin Williams was struggling with that. But, I mean, the most happy, seemingly happy people are.
It's true.
Kind of like Elvis, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway, I thought for a 1999 sci-fi kind of movie, I thought the set design was pretty good. Like, there were flying cars and briefly in one scene. I thought when the guy was putting on Andrew's human head, that was awesome. That was a good effect. And the artificial organs.
Yeah.
I thought that was neatly designed. So overall, I really liked the movie. Do I think the storyline could have, or plot, could have had more depth to it? Yes. So I do feel like it is lacking depth, but overall, I think it was a really good movie and good performance of Robin Williams.
Now, is his physical performance, you know, doing the robotic moves, as good as his hot dog performance in Mrs. Doubtfire? Or
I'm a hot dog.
It's hard to pick which is better. But I mean, one thing that is, you know, he's great at physical comedy. He's very over the top. You know,
I suggest our viewers go on YouTube and just look up a Robin Williams like stand-up clip. Yeah.
And you can also check out there's the HBO documentary that has a lot of that. So
yeah. Either one, check that out. Because that's where a lot of his, I mean, talent comes from.
Yeah.
And then he got into films. So.
Well, yeah, I agree. You know, for the most part, with all that, it is, you know, has that, as most Christopher Columbus movies do, it kind of has that magic, quote unquote, quality where it all kind of feels almost like a fairy tale or something along, or a storybook, that kind of thing. So, you know, pretty classic Chris Columbus, in my opinion. Yeah, Robin Williams, it can always find ways of making you laugh, making you tear up.
And that's why I wanted a variety in this episode. I wanted a movie to show off his voice actor work, and then a comedy, and then a drama.
Yeah. And then he can also, as we were saying, he can also, like in movies like 1 Hour Photo and Insomnia, he can kind of scare you at the same time. So the guy can do it all.
Yeah.
So
I kind of wish we added, you know, that, but maybe we'll do another tribute episode.
Part two.
Yeah.
Part two. So yeah, well, not a whole lot else to say. Definitely worth, even if it's not a masterpiece to me, it's still one that's one that I feel is deserving of a little bit more recognition than it is. I feel like I've never heard anybody really talk about it. So yeah, definitely check it out if that's in your vibe. I'm glad you suggested it, because it was one that was, I was lacking on my, you know, in my filmography, my watch list. So, yeah. Well, anything else?
I don't think so. I think it's just a shame that he's not.
Yeah.
Because just every Robin Williams movie I put on, now I'm going to go through like a Robin Williams, like binge watch era, but, and I'm going to have to watch Jumanji and all of his other movies that I haven't seen.
And I mean, I know, because I had mentioned maybe doing a Jumanji franchise show at some point. So maybe we could include that one in that one, maybe. Yeah. But
that'd be great.
We'll do it in one way or the other.
But just any Robin Williams movie I really enjoy watching. I don't know about you, but.
Oh, yeah. Can't go wrong, really.
But man, I wish I watched Mrs. Doubtfire series. That made me laugh a lot.
Life changing.
So. Oh, yeah. Oh, so life changing.
Yeah. But all right, well, out of five, I'll go 3.5.
3.5 for me too, because I, like I said, I feel like it did lack some depth to it.
Hmm. All right, well, you want to finish off with the Letterboxd review?
All right.
Reboo.
You can read the long one this time.
Whoa. What an honor. So, Silent Dawn. Oh, I follow him on Letterboxd.
Oh.
Cute. So, 1.5 for Mr. Dawn. Hmm. Or more specifically, as he puts it, 29 out of 100. He knew the number.
Hmm.
Yeah. Okay. The percentage. So, Silent says, Robin Williams being gone from this world makes me want to see Bicentennial Man in a different light, especially because much of the narrative centers around the aching sickness of morality and the eventual desire to succumb to it. But this bland late 90s Chris Columbus / celebrity vehicle is god-awful in the most routine, plodding way. IMDb has the running time as 2 hours and 12 minutes, but I don't believe that for a second. It begins as a simple family drama, sidetracks into an existential study, and ends in the tone of a love story, and all of it is terrible. Robin Williams is surely doing the best he can with a screenplay that, like iRobot, only engages on the surface level of Isaac Asimov's original writing. All the actors in this, Sam Neill, Oliver Platt, Imbeth Davidits, are trying so very hard, and they get absolutely nowhere with the material. And if it wasn't schmaltzy enough, James Horner's soundtrack arrives at every predictable emotional beat and sugars the hell out of it. It's also weirdly perverted, and not only because of the plot point where a robot falls in love with the granddaughter of a woman who also loved that very same robot, but because its supposed innocent clashes against the glimpses of unrestrained Robin Williams. If this wasn't mass-produced for a family audience, it would have been endlessly fascinating. Robin Williams wants to go to darker, stranger places throughout Bicentennial Man, but everything else is holding him back. The fact that this quote about sex stayed in the film seems to be a miracle in and of itself. And I quote here, that you can lose yourself, everything, all boundaries, all time, that two bodies can become so mixed up that you don't know who's who or what's what. And just when the sweet confusion is so intense, you think you're gonna die. You kind of do. Leaving you alone in your separate body, but the one you love is still there. That's a miracle. You can go to heaven and come back alive. You can go back anytime you want with the one you love. Whoever wrote that, that's quite the doozy.
Would you describe sex that way?
Full-heartedly. Anyways, so, whew, I'm exhausted. Thanks for sticking with me there, everybody.
This is one sentence, guys. So, Will rated it 2.5 stars. He said, I don't think there are any other actors that I miss more than Robin Williams.
That's a fair point. Probably in the majority there. So, yeah. All right. So then we'll just end off with some stuff we watched. I only have a couple of things because most of the things I watched, I put towards the bonus shows, which some of them are on, you know, the main feed and also on Bandcamp. And then others are coming soon. So I'm going to save, you know, even if you want to hear reviews that I have on Letterboxd, check out those shows separately. I rewatched with some coworkers Hereditary, the A24 film, or as I like to call it, Harry to Terry.
Didn't someone say that this is going to give ears or something?
Yeah, so we reviewed this one way back when it came out, and this was the first film by Ari Aster, who's gone on to do Midsommar and then Beau is Afraid this year. And this, I had forgotten how traumatizing this movie was. My coworker was, there's a point where he screamed. He said he probably would have nightmares when he got back home. And because all of this director's movies are all dealing with people dealing with trauma, typically family trauma. And this one especially. And it's amazing. It is so unsettling, shocking, but so well directed and acted, and the score is great. It's definitely one of A24's best movies. Especially. And so, yeah, definitely check it out. You just got to be, it is a pretty draining movie. So, but very worth watching. A lot of good ideas and a lot going on underneath. Then rewatched, I think really, honestly, the only other thing, let's see, a coworker had not seen Coraline. And so we rewatched, said, hey, even though I've seen it a million times, let's rewatch it again.
Because of me.
Oh, I mean, not even that. I watched it really for years and years and years since it came out, what, mid 20, 2000s?
Yeah, and apparently it's out in theaters on the 14th.
Yeah, with some apparently some behind or extra scenes, something like that.
We gotta go.
I hope it's around here, yeah. But, you know, done by Laika. It was their first feature-length movie, directed by Henry Selick, who also did Nightmare Before Christmas and James and the Giant Peach. The movie's, again, seen it countless times, amazing every time, looks amazing. The concepts, the visuals, the score, performances, everything is great. It's kind of, I feel like it's not, maybe not a movie that every single person loves, but I feel like it's hard to dislike. Yeah. You know, it's just got that very unique quality.
Maybe we'll have to review it.
Yeah, because we did do, I think we did it as a retro review way, way back when, but maybe we could do it either as a Laika Studios.
Well, we could review the, like if we can go to the theater and see. But don't you think Coraline would be such a good movie to turn into a live action movie? It'd be so creepy, but it would be so down, and Sarah Paulson better be the mom.
I love how this is like, this is probably brought up like every single episode.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Just the live action and
yeah,
but whatever. No. I don't care. Guys, let's make it happen.
Yeah.
DM Sarah Paulson.
Yeah. But it is awesome. You know, it's so enjoyable, very creepy though, but also very funny. It looks amazing. You know, never really gets old. So definitely check it out. And I just love stop motion animation, you know, and it's pretty masterfully done. So check that out. But all right, well, anything for you?
I haven't been watching many movies. I've been mainly watching Big Little Lies and Summer I Turned Pretty and Just Like That.
Just Like Date.
Just Like Date. But I think I might watch some Robin Williams movie and while I edit photos.
Sounds good. Yeah, I might go back and watch some more too. Or maybe some ones I haven't seen. But yeah, so I guess that is about it, unfortunately. Always hate to wrap it up, you know. But now, what's up?
Well, I just want to say next week we will be reviewing Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, the last Guardians of the Galaxy movie. And also Ant-Man and the Wasp, Quantumania.
Yeah.
And also it took me about 10 times to try to spell Quantumania on the lineup thing I made on Canva. But yeah, I'm looking forward to Superhero Week.
Yeah, I mean,
Marvel Week.
Because we finally got around to seeing Volume 3, and then we're going to be watching Ant-Man. We've gotten a little behind this year, but we're going to be watching Ant-Man sometime soon. And so that'll be coming soon as well. Very excited to talk about both of those. And I feel like there's something else I was going to say. Maybe not. But yeah, make sure to check out, you know, all the bonus shows on either Bandcamp or the ones that are available on the main feed. But there's probably will be a lot coming out, you know, in the next couple of months. So keep an eye out for that. A lot of fun.
And keep up with all things Film Buds on Twitter and Instagram.
And Facebook.
And Facebook, because I'm always posting lineups and what's coming next week, so you can stay updated.
Yeah. So and once again, thank you to all the people who might be new. Hopefully you stuck around this long in the episode.
I hope so too. I hope we didn't scare you off already.
Yeah. Thank you very much for finding our show, and we hope you'll subscribe and rate if you haven't already. Tell your friends, shout it from the rooftops. Go right now to your window and scream. About Film Buds. Not in general, just about Film Buds. Don't just go out there and scream. That'd be unsettling.
Should we do spring break?
Yeah, spring break. You know, so best of luck with that. Be careful.
Sometimes I'm glad this isn't recorded for YouTube.
Yeah.
We're looking into doing that, but I'm glad right now it's...
Yeah. And once again, you can follow us on both myself and Elle on Letterboxd, and all of those links are in the show notes. So please follow us there. And thanks for the people who already do and who, you know, support the show that way. Comment on our reviews and stuff with suggestions or comments on the show, stuff you like, don't like, questions that we can read live on the show and answer, all that good stuff. So make sure, get on it. What are you doing? Just sitting there. Get on it. Anyways, thanks for being here. thanks for being here as always.
Yeah, you know, walked about five feet to get to this room to record. Yeah. So yeah, no problem there.
Yeah, or as former host of the show Paul would say to his wife when they did it together, dear, thank you. So yeah, well, thank you as always for listening. We love doing the show, and we hope you do too. You get something out of it.
Yeah, and we're working on some really awesome lineups for the next few months. So, come on.
I can hardly wait.
Same here.
All right, well, yeah, we hope you enjoyed it even half as much as we did. And we'll see you next time.
All right, see you.